chapter 17. Glad he'd quit. We're going to be reading verses 14 through 21. 14 through 21. Would you please stand with me? Let us give our attention to the Holy Word of God. Brethren, let us hear God's inspired and preserved word. Verse 14, "And when they were come to the multitude, there came to him a certain man, kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is lunatic and sore vexed. For oft times he falleth into the fire and oft into the water. And I brought him to thy disciples, and they could not cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him hither to me. And Jesus rebuked the devil, and he departed out of him. And the child was cured from that very hour. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, Why could we not cast him out? And Jesus said unto them, Because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, Remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Howbeit, this kind goeth not out, but by prayer and fasting. Amen. May the Lord add his blessing to the reading of his wonderful word. Let's now unite our hearts in prayer. We will continue to stand before God unless you have a condition that makes it difficult for you to keep standing. In that case, please feel free to be seated. Brethren, we have the unspeakable privilege of going into God's presence. Let us go with our hearts fixed on Him. Oh, our gracious and heavenly Father, what a mercy, what a blessing it is that Thou hast raised us up from that death-like sleep, has raised us up on Resurrection Day, and drawn us together in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, our prophet, our priest, our King, our Savior, our Lord, our surety, our satisfaction, our substitute. We praise Thee, O Father. We praise Thee, O blessed Son. We praise Thee, Holy Spirit. Throughout this day, may our mouths be filled with praise. May we offer Thee the calves of our lips, the sacrifice of glory, praise, honor, and blessing unto Thee. We do bless Thee. We bless Thy holy name. And O God, by Thy grace, we will from this time forth and forevermore. Father, as our brother prayed earnestly earlier, oh, may this be some taste, even a little taste, of heaven this morning. Wilt Thou come by Thy Spirit, Lord Jesus, lover of our souls, O great and heavenly Bridegroom, come and ravish our hearts with Thy love. Draw us unto Thee. May we lean on Thy bosom. May we know Thy holy love to Thy people. Kindle that fire. O Father, as we sang, Thee will I love until my whole soul is filled with sacred fire. Come, Lord. These are not just pretty words. This is what our hearts pant for. Come, Lord. We want to know Thee. And Father, I pray that Thou wouldst bless the word preached this morning. We have offered up our psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. We have offered up prayers, and Thy blessed and infallible word has been read to Thy people. Now, Lord, we come to Thy word preached, how we need Thy mighty power. Father, this meeting will be in vain, but by Thy power, we believe in the Holy Spirit. Oh, if we have quenched Thee, if we have grieved Thee, O Spirit of God, put Thy finger upon our sins and grant us swift repentance. Expose our sins. Come with the sunlight of Thy Word and Spirit and shine into the deep and dark crevices and cracks of our souls, Lord. Expose the scattering cockroaches of our sins, and Lord, clear that place. Fill us with Thy Spirit. Oh, help us this very day to love and know and grip Thee by faith. Oh, Lord Jesus, how we pray for those in our congregation that are sick or are bearing, enduring difficult health conditions. We continue to pray for our brother Bill Millerick. Lord, heal him completely. Restore his strength, the use of his legs. Father, we do pray for brother Randy, for our sister Donna. We remember the souls, O righteous Father, of Ed Patterson, of Ken Sloan. Oh, my God in heaven. I pray for the men with whom I used to work. We are crying out to the only one who can open men's wicked hearts, who can break those flinty granite hearts with the hammer of Thy word, that can melt it with the heat of Thy glorious gospel in Christ. Come, Lord, and do it. Work in the lost here. Father, there are those that stand before Thee. Father, there may be hypocrites standing here that need to be smoked out of their filthy lie of a testimony, that they might lay hold of Christ. Give them no rest till they rest in Thee. Father, there are those who have heard Thy truths, who have heard the call of Thy gospel, who have heard the blessed promises of grace, of pardon, of everlasting life, and who stubbornly hold on to their pursuit of the flesh, who love their own hearts and their own wicked souls more than they could love Christ. Won't Thou come with the glorious light of Thy love, Lord Jesus? Track those hearts down. Humble them and draw them to Thyself in converting grace. Wilt Thou do it this morning, Lord? Now help me. I feel peculiarly my weaknesses, Lord. I cannot deliver such a passage. Who is sufficient, Lord, for these things? I can do nothing to save a soul. Father, I cannot dive off of this pulpit into the hearts of a single person here. I cannot pierce their hearts and cry out to flee to Christ or to take comfort in Christ. I cannot do it. but thy Spirit can. And we're pleading for conversion. We're pleading for sanctification. We're pleading for hearts filled with joy and love for the Savior, that we might worship Him with all our hearts. And now we ask it all in the name of Christ. Amen. Amen. Please be seated, brethren. Jesus, Peter, James, and John had ascended a high mountain, and there these three disciples witnessed the unspeakable glory of the God-man. The other nine disciples were not given this privilege. God doesn't have to reveal Himself to any sinner, even those that He's regenerated. But He was pleased to take these men to see His glory, His face shining like the sun, His clothes glistening, glimmering, dazzling white. The most spectacular, awe-inspiring revelation of Christ that any human being had yet experienced. And from this holy vision, they had descended to face once again the reality of the diseased, the deprived, and the demon-possessed. What an extraordinary contrast. Matthew loves those contrasts. And in the midst of this crowd, Jesus would learn of another failure on the part of His disciples. Jesus' disciples fail. Everyone born of God's Spirit here in this room knows, understands, and grieves over that. We fail. But as always, Christ in His grace took this opportunity. That failure led to a remarkable lesson in faith, which all of us here need to hear and embrace with all our hearts. Jesus taught His embarrassed and failed disciples about faith that moves mountains, which is the title of this message. Now, may our loving Heavenly Father, our gracious Heavenly Father, illuminate our hearts by the power of His Holy Spirit and fill us with the love of Christ Jesus, our Savior. So let us take up this notion first. Jesus, Peter, James, and John returned from the Mount of Transfiguration. We'll consider the A part of verse 14. The sacred text says, "And when they were come to the multitude." Well, that doesn't tell us very much. Matthew is in high form right here. As usual, Matthew is sparse on detail. We don't know where this is. We don't know who the crowd were. We're not entirely sure how they got there. Mark's gospel gives us a little clearer picture of the scene. And when He came to His disciples, that would be the nine that He left, because He had taken three with Him. He saw a great multitude about them. You see, a very large crowd surrounding his remaining disciples. And the scribes questioning with them. That's Mark 9:14. And Luke says, it came to pass that on the next day, when they were come down from the hill, much people met him. Obviously, Matthew is not concerned to tell us that this was the day following Christ's transfiguration, nor that Jesus was returning to the 9 disciples he had left waiting, nor that the scribes were questioning them. Rather, Matthew wants us to focus immediately on the sharp contrast between the glory of the transfiguration and the problem that was waiting for him at his return. I don't know if this is the Lord's pattern at all times, but I have noticed occasionally that after wonderful blessing from the Lord, the battle heats up and you face it the next day, if not later that same day. I've had glorious Lord's Day worship to wake up to unbelievable spiritual messes and trials on Monday. But here it is, 3 men that have seen Christ in his glory. They come down the mountain with this memory, no doubt lingering in their hearts. And here's another one of those crowds filled with sick people, filled with needy people, crying out to the Lord. And the other disciples, it looks like they're in some kind of problem, surrounded by the crowd and the scribes questioning them. What's awaiting the Lord? Well, we want to turn our eyes to the object to which Matthew points us. He doesn't give us any of the other stuff. He just takes us face first into the problem. A desperate father pleaded with Jesus to heal his son because the 9 disciples failed to do so. Verses 14 through 16. The first thing to catch our attention is this. There came to him a certain man, kneeling down to him. Well, that instantly should grip us. This is an unusual posture to take to the Lord Jesus Christ coming out of the crowd. He drops to his knees. And this man was a father. And his heart was so full of grief, pity, and agony for his son that he dropped to his knees before Jesus. There in the presence of a great mixed crowd, sick people, poor people, scribes, and even disciples, the man displayed humble reverence. On his knees, clearly the posture of reverence. And what drove him to this? The man's son was greatly suffering. The man's son was greatly suffering. The sacred text paints a dreadful, grim picture. This father cried out in desperation, "Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is lunatic and sore vexed. For often he falleth into the fire and oft into the water." The boy's sufferings were extreme and frequent. The Greek word translated lunatic literally means to be moonstruck. That is, to be under the supernatural influence of the moon. Well, the Roman goddess of the moon was named Luna, from which we get our word lunatic. Ancient cultures connected madness or lunacy, insanity, with the full moon or the phases of the moon. Even today, when strange things happen at night, some of us say, must be a full moon out tonight. The loonies are out, right? That's where this comes from. The Father's description of His Son's heart-rending symptoms resemble epileptic seizures. The sore vexed, those two words means greatly suffering. And when these great seizures ravaged this boy, he would fall into fires that were used for cooking or heat, or fall into some nearby body of water. Matthew does not tell us until verse 18 that the source of the boy's fits and convulsions was a demon. Once again, he's pointing us to the immediate problem. A man with a son who is suffering greatly. Never mind what the cause of it is at this moment. Look at his suffering. This is what's driving the man. Mark tells us that this was the man's only son. His only son. Mark tells us right away that the father pleaded, Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which hath a dumb spirit. Children, when you read the word dumb in the authorized version, it doesn't mean stupid or witless. The idea is that the boy cannot speak. He is dumb. He is mute. He can make sounds, but he cannot speak. And wheresoever, Mark takes up, wheresoever he taketh them, he teareth him, and he foameth, and gnasheth with his teeth, and pineth away. And we have parents here. How long could you stand seeing that? Would once be enough? We wouldn't want to see it once. But day after day, it is clear, when you read all the synoptic gospels regarding this passage, this is not something that happened once in a while. This is what's going on all the time. Can you imagine as he begins to groan and to make those awful sounds, and his body begins to go rigid and his eyes begin to stare off into space? It's coming again, 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 and you've got to get ready. You've got to get ready. Luke adds still more darkness to this intense suffering. Lo, a spirit taketh him, says the Father, and he suddenly crieth out. He screams. And it teareth him, that he foameth again, and bruising him, hardly departeth from him. That means leaves him with difficulty. It is as if he's reluctant to leave for the time, but before he goes, he's going to shake as much life out of that child as he possibly can. What terror, what trouble, what torment gripped this child's heart. He could not speak. He could not hear. He couldn't say, Mama, help, it's happening again. Without warning, a cruel, wicked demon would seize him by force, dashing him to the ground. The boy would scream as dreadful convulsions, violent shaking, flashing confusion overtook him. He jerked. He shuddered uncontrollably. Foam would spew from his mouth, gurgling as spittle flowed down his chin, trembling, twitching, grinding his teeth, uttering frightening sounds, and shrieking as his parts of his body would grow stiff and his eyes would get fixed. This was demonic torture of a human being made in God's image. The powers of darkness despise those made in the image of the God that damns them. Mark tells us that Jesus said to the man, How long has he been this way? And the father says, of a child, which means since he was very young. Does that happen? Yes. And I believe that our culture has virtually invited hell to destroy our children. And it's taking place in front of you if you're watching. If you have eyes to understand the scriptures and ears to hear the word of God, you have to understand that Satan has been using this culture to defile and to pervert children for decades, and it is getting deeper and darker all the time. What an extraordinary scene is before us. Here is a man pleading with all his heart that Jesus would heal his only son. The implication here is that devils can gain control of the human central nervous system, brutally afflicting their victims. Now, I must hasten to say, this does not mean that all seizures or all disease are demonic. But the scripture makes abundantly clear that sometimes that is exactly the case. The New Testament does reveal that demons are sometimes the sources of bodily affliction and disease. Now, in a scenario such as this, would not any parent anywhere in any age cry out? Would not any parent drop to his knees with the only one that seems to be a hope for his child? Please have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy on my child. Nothing. There is no hot poker jabbed into the heart of a parent more painful than the things that happen to your children. Yet despite all that, Matthew, Mark, and Luke describe the heart of this gut-wrenching event. And it's not the satanic hatred for human beings. That's real. It's not the demonic boy's distress, as dreadful as it is described here. The focal point was the 9 disciples Jesus left behind. The disciples could not cure the boy. That's why the man's on his knees before Jesus. The Father said, I brought him to thy disciples, and they could not cure him. Oh, what shame, what awkwardness and embarrassment must have cut through the disciples' heart. At that moment, with the whole crowd standing there. We must remember that in chapter 10, we read that Jesus gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out. And they've been doing it successfully. Having given them this power, Jesus had commanded them, heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, and cast out devils. They were to preach Christ, to call men, women, children, sinners, to repent and believe the good news, and to demonstrate the power of God's kingdom by casting out devils. And here's a moment that is stamped with fail. The disciples had even come back once, filled with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. And now they had to stand there hearing a man saying, they fail. Worse, they couldn't do it. They could not do it. This had to be a very powerful moment. What is the picture? Dismal failure. Crushing defeat. And public humiliation. At that, as the Father said with heartbreaking disappointment, they could not cure him. You ever been humiliated like that? It's enough for us to do something where we know we fail, whether we're failing as Christians or failing as unbelievers. We all fail from time to time. Now, I don't know about you, but failure never felt good to me. When I failed, I could never throw a party. I remember once, I know that I don't look like it, but at one time I played football. And I remember my father actually being out on the sidelines watching me play. And the coach said, go. And I had my opportunity. And we were lined up. The kick came. I looked up, and as I looked up, I looked right into the sun. And I lost what was in front of me, and I felt the ball hit my chest and bounce off. My team was standing there. The other team, by the way, recovered the ball. And I had to go in and sit down looking at Coach. I didn't feel good. if just nobody had been there, I still would have felt stupid. But I wouldn't have felt as bad. I had to look at the guys on my team. I had failed them. And worst of all, my dad was there. I would do anything that I could to please him. And as we came home, I made some comment, and he said, "You tripped over your own feet, clumsy." And that was his comment. No encouragement. Not for such a public failure. Failure in public really humbles people that have any sense of social contact. The disciples who had been successfully going from city to city, casting out devils, healing the lepers, doing all of these kinds of things, failed massively. Have you ever failed as one of God's people? That doesn't feel good either. So the disciples are no doubt dumbfounded. Isn't it interesting that none of the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, give us any explanation as to the reason for their failure? Now, Christ is going to put his finger on the heart of the matter in just a moment, but we don't hear anything that goes on in the hearts of the believers here. Nothing. They just failed. Jesus is about to tell them why. How did our Savior respond to this? Now, if we'd have written the Bible, it would sound different. There. Don't worry. Hey, everybody messes up once in a while. Don't worry about it. Isn't that what we would expect from Jesus? What would your Jesus have done? Let's look at what the real Jesus did. Have we not we learned that Jesus often said startling, shocking, unexpected things? Well, Jesus rebuked the man, the crowd, his disciples, and then he healed the boy. He cured that boy. Now consider this very carefully, brethren. Jesus rebuked them all. What a response. He rebuked them. Let's remember, Matthew would have been one of the nine. Matthew was there. Matthew was one of the failures. He felt the jolt of the words, "They could not cure him," and wrote them down for all of the Lord's people, for history. How he must have winced when he remembered that humiliating pain that filled his own heart as he wrote. Then Jesus answered and said, "O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you?" Jesus' words, generation, and the plural, you, indicate that he was not just talking to the man. Mark has Jesus replying to the man. But even then, the man would simply have been a representative of unbelieving Israel. But these words, generation, and you, plural, as verse 19 makes clear, Jesus was not simply including the crowd and the scribes, which of course he was, but he was even rebuking his dearly loved disciples. Beginning with the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus had addressed them as, "Ye of little faith." Chapter 6, verse 30. During a raging storm, in a sinking boat, he had rebuked them. "Why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith?" Had he not said to Peter, who had walked on the Sea of Galilee but sank, "O thou of little faith," come on now. For most people there, Jesus would have said, "Hey, good try, Peter. Not bad. You got further on the water than anybody in history, except for me." He grabs him in his love, and he reproves his little faith. "Why did you doubt?" He didn't cast him off. He didn't beat him up. But he brought him face to face with his problem. His little faith. After Jesus had fed thousands by multiplying bread and fishes, the disciples forgot to bring bread on a journey, and Jesus rebuked them. "O ye of little faith, why reason ye among yourselves because ye have brought no bread? Do you not remember how many people I've fed? Bread's not a problem. Your faith is." Your faith. Furthermore, Jesus regularly commended all who expressed faith in him, even praising a Gentile centurion and a Gentile mother. Praising them. "Great is your faith." As an eye and ear witness of Jesus' astonishing teaching and miracles, Matthew hammers the issue of discipleship and faith throughout his gospel. Jesus rebuked the man. Mark tells us that the father had said this. Matthew's not interested in this. He just wants us seeing the nub of the issue. Mark gives us detail. "And the man had come to Jesus out of the crowd and said," now listen carefully, "if thou canst do anything," if thou canst do anything, "have compassion on us and help us." And what did Jesus say to him? "If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth." The man, while apparently thinking he was showing some kind of faith in the Lord by having come to him and cried out to him, manifests his unbelief. If you can do anything, Jesus says, if you can believe, if you can believe, if you can believe, and he says that to every one of us, if you can believe, all things are possible to them that believe. All things. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief." Jesus rebuked the unbelieving nation of Jews, including its teachers, the scribes. "O faithless and perverse generation." The man, stop and think. The man who had sought out Jesus, his son, to heal his son, faithless, he'd left the crowd to go to Christ. Yes, faithless. The Jewish multitude that had heard God's word and heard the promises of Messiah and heard the fame of Jesus and had sought him out. Faithless? That's what Jesus says. Faithless generation. The scribes, the students of Scripture, the teachers of God's people, faithless? Yes. Even Christ's disciples. They're still standing in that crowd, as far as we can tell. They had been with him for years, seeing and hearing His heavenly ministry, the power of God's kingdom, who even worked the same miracles that He did in His name, faithless? That's what Jesus says. Is it any wonder that Jesus said, when the Son of Man cometh, will He find the faith on earth? Yes, faithless, and yes, again. There are people today that teach the false notion of faith, that somehow it's some kind of power that you can just flick the on switch and get God to perform for you. This is dangerous, false doctrine. Faith, true biblical converting and sanctifying faith, is a work of God's Holy Spirit. And it's real, no matter how small it is, it's real because of the Spirit of God, not because of something you've been able to work up. What does the word perverse mean? Jesus said faithless and perverse. Well, in this context, it means to depart from correct spiritual values or behavior, to leave, to go away from that which is right. Perverse, twisted. He's speaking to a generation that has the Scriptures that talk about Him, and yet none of them comes repenting of his sins and saying, Thou art the Christ. They come saying, Heal me, heal me, heal me. For years, Israel has been going to Jesus and saying, Heal me, without saying, Save me. Save me from my sins. Save me from my rebellions. Save me from my law breaking. Save me from myself. He said, Here, heal me, fix me, do this for me, please. And Christ, in His astonishing mercy and grace, did that. But ultimately, it was to no avail for most of Israel, including its leaders. It brought glory to God. They talked about Jesus. Who's ever seen anything like this? Wow. But the Lord didn't do all this to entertain anyone or just to blow their minds. He did this because as Messiah, He brought the glories of the kingdom into this world to show those to whom the promise was initially given the greatness of God's mercy, the greatness of God's love, the greatness of God's power, the immensity of His kingdom. But He calls them what they've proven themselves to be for years: faithless and perverse. Now that must have stung the disciples a little bit. They knew that they believed that Christ was the Son of the living God. Peter had confessed that in chapter 16. And Peter, James, and John had just been on the mountain with Him. Thankfully, they were probably standing back, watching the other nine as Christ reproves the gathering. The issue, my dear brethren, was faith versus unbelief. And that's always the issue. That's always the issue. The issue with the living God is always faith. Faith in Him. Faith in His words. A life that should live in accord by faith with His words. Not just saying, oh, I believe. Oh, I signed a card in the fifth grade. Oh, I walked the aisle, prayed the prayer. I did all that. And I was lost as a Hindu for years. We're saved when the Spirit of God opens our hearts and we repent of our sins. That's the ultimate first sign of life. Repentance. You see your sin. I'm not arguing that maybe later in your Christian life you may even repent more intensely than the first day you believed. That's certainly possible, and I know many Christians who've had experiences like that. But you're not alive in Christ until there is a repentant heart in you. So, faith stands before us as the issue of this whole pericope or this whole paragraph. But even in the face of unbelief, the gracious Son of God then said, "Bring him hither to me. Bring him here." He has watched the apostasy of the leaders. They don't believe he's the Christ. In fact, they think that he's satanically empowered, in league with the devil. The people mouth good things about him. "We've never seen anything like this in Israel." But no repentance. In the cities where his greatest miracles were worked, he said, "You'll be brought down to hell because all of those miracles didn't bring anybody to repentance. It brought them to excitement. It even brought them to gratitude, but it didn't bring them to repentance." Are you repentant? I'm not asking, did you have a feeling once a long time ago called repentance? Would you characterize your life among the other things that you would say about it as repentant? Present tense. The believer, as Martin Luther said, is born to repent. We're born of God's Spirit ever to repent in this world because we fail. We do. We fail. Our best days, our best works would send us to hell because they're all stained by our weaknesses and our failures. We need something far greater than our sins, something far greater than our little attempts to honor the Lord. And I'm not saying that attempting to obey Christ is non-important, not at all. But what I'm saying is, every day we need to believe Christ. Every day. Doesn't matter how long you've been a believer. You can't get up and say, I've been doing really well lately. You know, I'll just go on and head out into the world today and take on whatever comes my way. If I get in any trouble, I'll call on the Lord. I trust no one would be that absurd, or if I can say it this way, that blockheaded. No, we need Jesus Christ every day. And so Christ in his mercy casts out the devil immediately. In the face of unbelief, Christ cast this devil out. Jesus rebuked the devil and he departed out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. That's a way of saying, right away, it was done. It was finished. The boy was cured. Now the disciples must have thought this was wonderful, incredible. He's seen the Lord. They'd seen the Lord do this before, but it especially must have been kind of a keen, piercing thing to watch him go out and the demon was gone. And they had labored and tried and failed. So Jesus' disciples ask why they had failed. That's our fourth major point, and he exposed their unbelief. Just as faith is always the issue with God, its counterpart is unbelief. And we've always got to deal with that in our flesh. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart. Let's not miss that. They come quietly, privately. They've had enough public exposure today. They come quietly. Quietly and privately. Why could not we cast them out? Why couldn't we do it? Knowing as we do from the testimony of Scripture that these disciples had cast out devils in Christ's name previously, we may sympathize with their bewilderment and humiliation. Have you ever been pretty good at something and then massively fail at it and wonder, I've done this so many times, how could I have failed? Or I've handled this so many times, how did I fall on my face? Now listen, if I'm not talking to you, please, after the sermon, come and tell me how you're doing it. This is as practical as it gets. Day by day, my brethren. Faith or unbelief? Every day. Now, we certainly can understand why they came privately to say, hey, what went wrong? But notice the plural we. Don't miss little things like that. Why could not we cast him out? It wasn't as if Andrew or Thomas or Matthew came and said, well, you know, I was the one leading this thing and I just really botched it up. I failed. I don't know why. Why is there that plural there? And I would say that it appears that all of them must have participated at some level in the attempt to cast out that stubborn demon. You can see the picture, can't you? One brother going, come out in the name of Jesus. Come out in the name of Jesus. Well, that's not working. And someone else steps up. We've done this before. Come out in the name of Jesus. And the boy is just wallowing and foaming. We couldn't do it. And I don't think I'm reading anything into this because Jesus did not hesitate to tell them because of your plural unbelief. It doesn't say thine or thee or thou, but your. This is plural. It was a group failure. All were guilty. Now, a disciple of the Lord Jesus may receive many a rebuke from the Savior. He's promised to do that and to correct us and to chastise us because he loves us. But it is doubtful that any sting like hearing, your faith in me is remarkably small. Let's be honest again. If the Lord were to appear to us personally, each one of us individually, if he were to look us in the eye and say, how's your faith meter doing? How would we answer him? Oh, faith. Whew. I was off the charts yesterday. Would we? Do you get honest with God about your faith? Do you day by day know that you need to trust him each day? How would it be to hear, as he says to the churches, five of the seven churches in the book of Revelation, he rebukes them. And there's those words that I don't want to hear. I have somewhat against thee. Now he loves them. He gave himself for them. This is not to be a downer for everybody, but it is to be a reality check. The Lord isn't just all pamper and cotton candy. He calls us to live for him, to walk with him day in and day out. And that begins, it continues, and it concludes with faith. And some of us have greater faith, greater abilities of belief than others. That's true. And even those who have great faith can wax and wane, right? Have dry seasons We have seasons where it just seems like every day, oh, we're on the mountaintop. We're with the Lord at the Mount of Transfiguration. And then all of a sudden it seems like we drop off into the valley of the shadow of death for 6 months. But faith is the issue. Faith. Little faith or great faith, it's still faith and a product of the Holy Spirit. So we're thankful that we have any faith, but we don't want to leave it as little faith. How much faith do I need to get by? That should never be a question for a Christian. Well, more about that in just a moment. So, just to make sure that the disciples did not fail to grasp his point, Jesus continued, "For verily I say unto you," plural, "if ye have faith as the grain of a mustard seed, ye," it's all plural, "shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you." Here, Jesus introduced his answer with an amen pronouncement, with his verily, that's the Greek, amen. "Truly, I say to you, verily, I say to you," to emphasize both its truth and its importance. It's wake up when the Lord says, verily. I mean, we should listen to everything that he says, but he's emphasizing when he says, amen. And what follows that? Well, by saying this, we don't want to miss the Lord's point either. By saying what he said here, he's saying that their little faith did not amount to a mustard seed. If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, and they didn't, that's the point. If you had it, you could move mountains. Faith that moves mountains. So he's not only reproved them, but he's told them a truth. Graciously, but painfully, your faith is the problem. And it's so small, it didn't even amount to a mustard seed. That's why that child still had a devil. Now he's going to add something to that in just a moment. But this is the issue. Now, they knew how small a thing a mustard seed was. Jesus was not saying that they had no faith, but he was saying that it was exceptionally small. Now, the thing is, it's probably not just about the size of it. Because once again, any faith is real faith. It's the product of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith is something that the Holy Spirit works in the human heart. It is a glorious grace from God. So even little faith can be effectual. But the little here probably focuses on the weakness of it. The weakness of their faith. It was small and ineffectual. Is Jesus being hateful? No, he's loving them. Is he beating them up? Is he beating the sheep, as some people might be tempted to say? No, he loved them. And so he plainly told them the problem. You have weak faith. But if your faith were to increase, if it work its way all the way up to the size of a mustard seed, you could move mountains. You could move mountains. Now, in Jewish literature, the idea of moving mountains was proverbial. This was something they all would have understood instantly. Today, people take verses like this and say, "I want a Cadillac, and if I believe it, nothing can be impossible to me." Right? Well, that's error. Jesus isn't talking anything about that. There's a context. Failed disciples, and he has given them a mission. Therefore, he's telling them, whatever you do in my service as I command and send you out, You will do it and be able to move things out of the way that are just like mountains. You will be able to move every obstacle from what hinders you and your service to me. He's not saying this is free reign. Nothing will be impossible. Well, great. I'd love for these people to throw themselves out of an airplane, you know, and say, nothing? Right. I'm jumping out. Believe in God. That's not going to happen. It isn't going to happen. It isn't what Jesus is talking about. My dear friends, the Bible is a book of context, and it must always be read so. Well, Jesus was not telling his disciples to go find the nearest mountain range and work on dumping it over into the next country. He wasn't saying anything remotely like this. He was using something that they would have understood. He was using a clear proverb. And what he's saying is that if you just have a little bit of faith, there are things before you as you serve me that you'll be able to move. And God's people find that out if they're walking with Christ. They learn this. Things look impossible. And by prayer, faith, the Lord just moves that grand series of mountains right out of the way. Jesus' stinging rebuke came with a loving life lesson. He teaches them in the middle of this. He didn't go, all right, you failed. I'm really embarrassed here. The kingdom looks bad because of you. He's never done that to you, has he? We might do it to ourselves. We're pretty good at doing that about others. This is not the way Christ did. He exposes them, he rebukes them, and then he teaches them. It's exactly what the Word of God does. It exposes us, it rebukes us, and it teaches us so that we can walk in the way. And that's what the Lord's doing. He teaches his beloved disciples here. Now, let me put it to you a slightly different way. Jesus is saying, believe me, trust me, and you will overcome the greatest obstacles in what I give you to do. He's about to tell them in a few more chapters to go turn the world to him. How impossible is that? But they're going to see mountains move as they take the gospel and advance the kingdom into satanic-controlled countries. You will overcome. It was as if Jesus had said, in my mercy, grace, and love, I have been proving to you all along that your faith was small. Have you been hearing me, O ye of little faith? Weak and often ineffective, you have heard my praise of those who have great faith. Even when they were Gentiles, you have been with me over 3 years. I have healed the sick, cleansed the lepers, raised the dead, and cast out devils, and you have done the same in my name. With my constant corrections and reproof, you, of all people, should understand the principle of trusting me completely. Now, brethren, could he say that to us? What has he done for you? Has he ever sent the Holy Spirit to you? Has he shown you your sin? Did it break your heart, and did you realize how wicked and wretched and rebellious you were against the living God? Oh, what love. Did he make you see that without a Savior, you would be forever lost? You had to have the bad news before the good news became precious to you. And when he came, did he take you out of the miry clay and set your feet upon the rock? Did he fill your heart with repentance? Did he fill your heart With faith, did you really believe that looking up at the cross and looking down in the tomb and looking up at the right hand of the Father, that this was your Savior, this was your hope, this was your life? This is what Christ does. And did he give you his Spirit? Not only did he send that glorious Spirit to show you what you were, did he take up residence within you so that you could take a book that at one time said nothing to you, no matter how many times you got up and did your quiet time? Did he send the Spirit and teach you from his book and show you how to love him and show you how to walk with him? Does he fellowship with you in prayer? Does he take you day by day and help you to overcome those sins that cluster around you like a swarm of wasps? And does he preserve you at the end of the day, throughout the day, so that at the end of the day, you bow before him and say, thank you for preserving me another day? It's all by faith. It's all by faith. His gracious faith. Why did the disciples fail? We don't know any details except this. Their faith was the problem. And Jesus told them instantly. Why couldn't we do it? Because of your unbelief. Just that simple. Straightforward. Ouch! Couldn't you said it nicer than that? Couldn't you say, well, you know, I know you're having a rough day. I know you've been under a lot of stress lately, so your unbelief in me gets a pass for that. That's the way some of us live. And that's why a lesson like this is here and valuable for us. We live by faith day by day because that's what God has ordained, to trust the living Christ for everything. Everything. Can't I trust me a little bit? Are you that foolish? That's the setup for a nosedive. No, don't trust you. Trust Christ. Live Christ. You see, he didn't say, you know, it's just like Moses. Those Israelites were so hard-headed. I couldn't teach them anything. I'm going to get rid of you and get some more disciples. Could he have done that? Well, let me just say this. He didn't, and he doesn't, because he loved us so that he gave his life that we might have everlasting life. His blood was shed that we might live for eternity. He became our great substitute. He bore our cross. He was nailed to that rugged cross on Calvary. His back was flayed. His face was beaten to a pulp. His crown of thorns driven into his head. And as those nails held him to the cross, my friend, all of this was for his people to say, I believe. That's it. Your life, your eternity is wrapped up. I believe him. Well, Jesus revealed the nature of the demon. In verse 21, Jesus added, howbeit this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Now, in their weak faith, the disciples had attempted to cast out a particularly stubborn and rebellious this kind of demon. Now, Jesus does not elaborate, but it does specify some difference within the categories of wicked spirits. When we enter into spiritual warfare, when we enter into spiritual warfare, that's not something off out in the future. You're in the battle today. Or you're losing if you're not realizing that. You're in the battle. The enemy's not taking vacations. There is this kind, and when we enter into battle with this kind or any other demonic conflict, we must be aware that some are more evil, more powerful, more obstinate than others. Oh, demons are just for like people on drugs, right? What book are you reading? American Christians, wake up. Do you not understand the demonic nature of our culture? Wake up. You are in a battle with the powers of darkness. But if you have faith in Christ, you can not only move mountains, you can resist the powers of darkness. You can. It is the truth. Listen, my dear brethren. We must have a spiritual warfare level of faith. We need to grow. Now these, by the way, this prayer and fasting is an important part here. Jesus is not denying what he's just said. The reason you couldn't cast them out was because of faith. He's not turning around and saying something contradictory. This only comes out by prayer and fasting. He's adding to the picture that you and I must learn from. Prayer and fasting are means of faith, of means of grace, by which our faith is strengthened. And what he's telling us is that in these battles, he, as the living Christ, can say, out, and they must come out. And when we go in his name, we're weaker than he. And there are times when it is a greater struggle for us in battles like this. And he's saying, now, because Jesus didn't have to pray and fast to cast him out, did he? That's for us. And there are times when we are struggling before God, struggling with the sin, struggling with the onslaught of the enemy, attacking our mind, violating our hearts. We must pray and fast along with resisting the powers of darkness. There's a stain in Luther's former cell, monk cell, his study, where he felt the intensity of Satan so much that he threw his inkwell, seeing and sensing and feeling. And he was taking on the very powers of darkness itself when taking on Rome. Well, you're taking on things every day. Unfortunately, we've gotten so used to our culture that often we don't realize we're swimming in a cesspool. And therefore, the powers of darkness can more easily deceive us. John Calvin captures the issue well. He says, you are effeminate exorcists and seem as if you were engaged in a mock battle, got up for amusement. But you have to deal with a powerful adversary who will not yield till the battle has been fought. Your faith must therefore be excited by prayer. And as you are slow and languid in prayer, you must resort to fasting as an assistant. Close quote. I agree with that. Do you understand the battle you're in? Do you have failures? Let me tell you. God in his mercy teaches us, even when we fail, in fact, especially when we fail. And he points out pretty quickly what the problem is. He didn't hesitate with his disciples. I mean, if you want to get on your face and say, I don't know why I'm so powerless, Lord, get on your face and keep crying out to him. He will show you. He's not going to show you everybody else's problems. He's going to show you yours. And then you'll begin to find out why there's such a struggle. Is this real? Yes, it's real. The battle with the powers of darkness, my brethren, is long, difficult, arduous, and painful. And we have some losses. But God in his grace always cleans up and picks up his children and puts them back in the battle. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The disciples had tried and apparently given up. And Jesus said, well, there's more to this than what you were doing. Prayer and fasting would have been necessary as you continued taking on this obstinate kind of devil. Well, we have applications. We can only mention them lightly. What do we do with a passage like this? Well, I trust you've already gotten something from it. But here's the first thing to say. Let us with all our hearts love and praise the Lord Jesus for his daily patience with our little faith. Let's love him because he loves us. He loved us first, and whatever faith you have, it is because of his blessed Spirit. He loves his people. He's not here to stomp them in the ground, but I will tell you this. When you're ready to do business with him, when you get serious with Christ, he will tell you plainly and clearly, here's your problem. And it'll all be resolved in him. God's love for his elect, dear brethren, is so great that he gave his only begotten Son. Does not Scripture say, he that spared not his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Well, will he not give you greater faith then? What did the apostles say to the Lord? Increase our faith. When was the last time you prayed that? Increase our faith. No thanks, I got plenty. We're not silly enough for that, are we? But sometimes that's actually the way we live. No, Lord, increase my faith. Show me how I may more and more greatly honor thee. Show me how to trust thee more. Now be careful when you're praying that. If you don't mean it, you're not going to be ready for what's coming. And even when you mean it, you may not mentally be ready for some of the things he's going to bring you through. But everything he brings, at the heart of it lies the issue of faith. He is testing your faith. And he'll reprove you when your faith is little, but he'll teach you how to go on because he loves his people. He doesn't spank them and cast them off. He says, this is where you were wrong. Repent. Now, this is how we walk. My dear brethren, his sustaining grace and his everlasting love in Christ and the innumerable gracious answers he grants to our weak, limited prayers is astounding. Let's praise him that he's so patient with us. Every day he's patient with me. I don't even know how I get through some days other than amazing grace. Just his mercy. Well, finally, we must remember that in dealing with the living God, it must always be by faith in Jesus Christ. That's it. We must remember that in dealing with God, it's always by faith in Jesus Christ. If we would have faith that moves mountains, we must pray and believe the word of Christ. Not in some static, floating in the mind way. Oh yeah, Jesus, I've heard about that. No. I mean, real day-to-day life, putting things on the altar and saying, Lord, here it is. Here's what I am. I just want to be a living sacrifice for you today. Grant me the grace, grant me the faith to be that. Increase my faith. Show me how to live in such a way that brings thee great glory. The failed disciples were surrounded by the crowd. They were being questioned by the scribes. And they knew themselves that they had failed in relieving this child. A lot of people would give up at that point. But Jesus rebuked them, corrected them, and then later sent them into the world. And we see Jesus working with them every bit of the way, taking his glorious gospel. Read the book of Acts, and you will see that they learned their lessons here. They moved mountains to bring the gospel to the lost. spiritual mountains. So would we move mountains? Well, it must be by faith alone in Jesus Christ alone. It's all of God's grace, but he gives us that grace so that we will believe and follow him. Seeking first the kingdom of God. Christ's compassion toward the teeming multitudes was overflowing with heavenly grace, and it was quite remarkable considering the fact that they loved his healing, but they didn't repent. But his disciples were going to go on to change the world. We are his disciples. There will be no world changing. There will be no life changing. There will be no family changing. There will be no permanent good done by one of us apart from faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. But in him, the mountains have to give way. Do we believe that? I hope so. May we look to the Lord Jesus Christ and live. Thank you, Father, for your grace and goodness. Without thee, Lord Jesus, we can do nothing. 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 So help us. Bless thy people. Fill them with thy love and tender mercies. Fill them with thy spirit. Reprove us. Rebuke us. Correct us. And give us the strength that we need. May we bring thee glory. Increase our faith, I pray. In the name of Jesus, amen. Brethren, let's stand. Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's go in his name.